Good morning, Harvest. It is so good to be here, and Flav, thank you for that. It's funny because he stole my introduction. I was just going to tell you, basically, if you thought you knew Flav, you'll know a lot more about him after this sermon. So, he's a great guy. I love him, and I am thankful that he's my oldest brother, and he's just been a great example for our family, being faithful, and I'm just glad that he's here. Part of the North Shore campus, and I remember back when we were at the Winnetka's campus, right? We were all over the place, and Flav served every once in a while, and he, you know, went out of town, did ministry in California, and now he's back here, worship pastor here, and I'm like, it's amazing. So Flav, love you, love what you're doing here, and the Lord's using you. I love it. As Flav was saying, my name is James. I am actually one of the student pastors in Crystal Lake. Recently transitioned to that role, and I'm just excited because I love working with students. I love preaching the Word of God, and I love the vision of our church, to go make disciples. So the word that I have for you this morning is actually something that God's been working through me before I even found out I was preaching. I didn't know that I was going to preach a couple weeks ago, and I was like, it's interesting how the Lord works everything for his good, and how even though he's working in my life, this is something that we could all use into the new year, how we could set our goals to glorify the Lord in 2023. So as we begin, let me just pray. There's no better way to start a sermon than by prayer, asking for the Holy Spirit to just speak through me. So let's do that. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this year that you've given us, another year to dwell among your creation, your children, God. And I just want to thank you for every single person that's here today in the house of the Lord, and for all those people that are going to hear this message at some point. Lord, I'm praying that you bless this church and continue to use us to glorify your name throughout all of our communities, Father, throughout into our families, into our workplaces, because everything that we do, God, is for you and for your glory. So speak through your word this morning. Encourage us. Challenge us to be more like you. Praying in Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we begin, I just want to start by, just so that you guys get to know me a little bit better, it'll be easier for you to kind of like listen to who's this guy preaching. We've never heard him. Well, you've probably seen me on stage. I've done worship with Flav here a couple times, and I get to travel around other campuses doing worship, so if I've seen that guy a little bit, well, yeah, you might have seen me on stage here or streamed from the Rolling Meadows campus. But another thing about me, I actually love sports. I love soccer, and for those of you who have been keeping up with it, last month was the greatest time that I've had in 4 years. The World Cup. FIFA 2022 World Cup happened in December. Should have been in the summer. They moved it to December, which was awful because I'm like working, trying to watch games, waking up at 4 a.m. to watch games. Like it was just one of those things. But I consider myself a fan. I am the person that knows who's playing. I know all the rosters. I know who didn't even make the roster due to injury. So it's like I take pride in being a soccer fan. However, one of the greatest things I did accomplish this year watching the World Cup is I actually got my wife to watch him with me. I've talked to men. I play soccer with a lot of people, and men in their 40s, 50s, 60s have said, I've tried my whole life to get my wife to watch a game with me. And I'm like, well, I accomplished that this year. I did that. She was watching every single game. In fact, towards the end of the tournament, the games were between 9 and 1 p.m., so I'm in meetings, I'm meeting with students, I'm planning stuff, and I just didn't have that much time to watch the game. But Deb is texting me. She's calling me. She's like, hey, did you see what happened? Hey, Messi scored a goal. He did this. Oh, bad call by the referees. I'm like, one, who is this person? But two, I was like, I did a great job. I'm like, well done, James. We're 3.5 years in marriage. I'm like, I did a fantastic job with that one. And it was amazing. However, as time starts to go by, there's something that just doesn't feel right, like in me. And the Holy Spirit starts to work. The Holy Spirit starts to like tug at your heart a little bit, right? And he posed a couple questions to me one morning during my devotional time. And it was like, well, you're so passionate about soccer. You're so passionate about, you know, this game. There were 4 billion people that watched the World Cup. I was one of them, for sure. But in that widespread of people and all that action, the Lord said, are you as passionate about me as you are about the sport? I was like, oh, man. I'm like, it's December. It's the end of the year. I've done all these things. I've done these student camps. But he was saying, are you consistently professing my name the way you're asking people to watch these games, the way you're talking about these games? All I did was watch soccer for a month straight. It was amazing. But I start to lose sight of what I'm actually meant to be doing. Am I giving praise to God as much as I am to Messi? This guy's the greatest soccer player ever. However, we have a God who created this man. So it's like, what's going on here? And then you start to think, well, we all have things in our life that we kind of put on a higher pedestal than the Lord. They're good things. Why? Because they're all from the Lord. It could be a job. It could be a raise. It could be family. There's so many things that the Lord has given us. It could be grandchildren or a child in your family. Like, those are all amazing things. But are they number one on the list and God is second? So it's January and the Holy Spirit is just like tugging on my heart. So I'm preaching to myself as much as I'm preaching to you guys. To go back to our first love. To go back to loving the Lord and actually living our life 100% for him and not for us. Why? Because he deserves it. We're singing these songs like, holy, holy is the Lord. Do we actually mean it? Or are we just saying that during 30 minutes of worship Sunday morning, and then the rest of the week, we're doing our own thing? So for me, I was like, well, how can I grow? Lord, okay, I get it. You're tugging at my heart. I need to be more like you. Who is a great example for me? And obviously, right away, I thought of King David, right, from the Old Testament. He was a man after God's own heart. So I'm like, perfect. This is the type of guy that I want to strive to be like. And we know from scripture that he was faithful to the Lord and he did whatever he could to please God, right? As a shepherd, as a king, he went to God for wisdom. As we sang earlier, again, it's like, Lord, give me wisdom. David did that daily. As a shepherd, as a nobody, he went and asked God for wisdom. But then when he became king, when he actually became something with his life, he's still going back to the Lord. He's like, I need your help. I want us to turn to 1 Chronicles 16, and this is basically, we're going to see David's response to moving the Ark of the Lord back to Jerusalem. And we're going to be going through his song of thanks in 1 Chronicles chapter 16. But before we do that, I just want to get some context going so that we know what's happening. I did some researches over the last couple weeks as I'm like, well, 1 Chronicles, these are basically the same stories from 1 and 2 Samuel. So what's going on here? Interesting enough, 1 Chronicles was written towards, you know, 400-500 BC, which is much later on than when David reigned as king. 400-500 years after that. And I was like, well, what's the purpose of these books? So then after some studying, I really learned that the chronicler, who really we don't know who the author is till this day, he was writing to the Jews. He was writing to the people of Israel. He's like, okay, you guys have forsaken the love of Christ. You guys have left your first love. And what happened? You guys were in exile. Babylon went, took over. You guys actually went to there. And, you know, the story of Daniel. Like, a lot of them just gave in to the culture that they were oppressed to. But Daniel and a few were just faithful to the Lord and they did whatever they could. But those that have forsaken their religious practices really started to combine some things to make it easy. Oh, well, I'm making sure I'm doing what they said, and but I'm still keeping some of this, right? And it's like, well, they're forsaking the relationship that their fathers, their ancestors really built up to have. And at this portion, the chronicler is really, this is after they've gone back home. They've gone back to Jerusalem. They've taken their lands back. But even when they went back home, they didn't go back to who they used to be. They kept on to their new traditions. Well, this is better for me. This is more comfortable for me. But the chronicler right now, what he's trying to do, he's trying to get the people of Israel to go back to seeking God, right? Not forsaking him. So that's what he's doing. And all throughout 1st and 2nd Chronicles, if you start reading them, you start to realize there's not really much negativity in there. Why? Because these are stories of hope. He's trying to make David and all these people that he's talking about like seem great to remind his people of God's greatness. And I think it's interesting because I'm the same way. I needed to be reminded this past year of like, well, cool, I love all these other things, but what am I actually passionate about? And this is where we get the title Zeal. It's like, am I actually a zealous follower of Christ? Or am I just, oh, I'm going to worship the Lord when I want. I'm going to live my life a certain way. For me and like for my brother Flav, like we're on staff at the church. So easy we could just get lost in the, oh, I'm working for the Lord instead of actually living it out in our hearts. So that's where we are. Being reminded of how to actually worship the Lord this year in 2023. So before we jump into 1 Chronicles 16, I just want to recap what's going on between chapters 10 through 16, just so you guys are up to speed. Chronicles 10, Saul is king, and he actually dies. Then in chapter 11, David becomes king, and then for the next couple chapters, he starts working for the Lord. And one of his main things was, I want to bring the Ark of the Lord back to Jerusalem. Why? Because when they lost their land, it was taken from them, and they didn't have it. But in 1 Chronicles 13, 4, David reminded his people what they're going to do, what is meant for them to do. He wanted to remind them to bring back the Ark of the Lord back home, where it belonged. And it says in 1 Chronicles 13, 4, for we did not seek it. They didn't seek the Ark of the Lord back in the days of Saul. Why? Because they were so focused on their own thing, they were forsaking what God had originally given them. So this is just David's reminder right here really led to the righteousness of the Israelites moving forward because they moved the Ark of the Lord back. And in the first couple verses of chapter 16, David is really setting up a worship service, building an offering. They're burning offerings, peace offerings, sacrificing offerings. Why? Because they did what they were supposed to. They brought the Ark of the Lord back. And this is where we are at this point. 1 Chronicles 16, verse 8. And this is David's prayer. And in his prayer, there's three things that we're going to learn today. We're going to learn to sing your song internally, to sing your song fervently, and to sing your song vertically. Those are the three things we're going to walk through today. And it's right in the text. So there's nothing that I'm saying that isn't from here because, right, we're a Bible reading church and this is speaking to us. So that's what we're going to do right now. So in doing these things, singing internally, singing fervently, and singing vertically, David is leading Israel in a time of worship to remind them who God is. And he's reminding them that they need to worship him continually. And for us, that's what we're going to do. We're literally going to walk in David's footsteps, recalling what the Lord has done in 2022 so that in 2023, we could go tell people, tell our friends, tell our families, tell our neighbors what the Lord has done. Why? Because in doing so, we're giving glory to God because it's not what we did. It's what he did through us. So let's jump in. Verse 8, it says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people, sing to him, sing praises to him." We've been doing that all morning, right? "Tell of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works of the Lord that he has done." Right away, David starts his prayer by thanking God and saying, hey, let's give praise to him. They gathered all together, they're giving praise. But his first action for them is to remember all that the Lord has done and to seek the Lord. So point number one, sing your song internally. What David is doing here, again, as I said earlier, he's telling the Israelites to remember how God has been faithful in the past. Because when he was faithful and they obeyed him, he kept supplying for them. But again, what happened over time, the Israelites were forsaking the work of their fathers and neglecting to seek God. Why? Because they were so focused on earthly things, things that really didn't matter. So the chronicler is trying to remind Israel of the covenant that God made with Abraham. He's trying to tell them, go back to seeking God and not worthless items. He wants us to remember what life is really about. It's not about, oh, how is this going to benefit me? No, it's about worshiping God in all that we do. Further down, it really states it clear. For all the gods of the people, in verse 26, it says, for all the gods of the people are worthless idols. When I think of wasting your opportunity for something that, you know, is more about you rather than what it's actually meant for, my brothers and I joke around about our mom. She loves when we have guests coming over, my mom cares more about how the house looks. She opens all the cupboards and every cup in there, and she's like, is it clean? There's dust up here in the corner. I'm like, Mom, no one's going to get a ladder and look up there. She goes, did you clean your closet? I'm like, why would they open my closet? She goes, did you take your clothes underneath the bed that you're hiding that you're supposed to put in your closet that you didn't put in the closet? I was like, how do you know? No one's going to put their head underneath my bed and do that. Well, you see, my mom is, she's amazing. However, she loves the way people view her. And she wants to be held at a high standard. She's like, we're Herlos, and we have a big family. There's 6 kids, but you know what? Our house is in tip-top shape. But that sounds funny, but at the same time, it's like we see that often either in our lives or even in Scripture. Mary and Martha, right? What happened? Mary was at the feet of Jesus. Martha's working. She's trying to, like, do all these things, and Martha's angry. She's actually angry at Mary, and she's like, but Lord, why? Look at what she's doing. She's not working. She forgot. Martha forgot who she was in the presence of. My mom, again, amazing person, but sometimes she gets so carried away on what is meant to be that we're forgetting what it's actually for. But we've all been there. It was just Christmas and New Year's party probably yesterday, or if you're having a lunch today, our house has to look a certain way. We have family coming in from out of town, fix all the picture frames, paint the walls, you know, make it look clean. Why? Because when people come, we have to make sure we look great. But at the same time, we're losing track of what it's all about. We get so consumed by, I want to be like this, that we forget what it's actually about. And what David's doing here, he's taking us and just realigning us with the Lord. He's reminding us of the goodness of God. And in this prayer of thanksgiving, he's telling Israel, remember all that God has done for you. And as we start reading verse 15 on, it says, remember his covenant forever, that the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations, the covenant that he made with Abraham. What covenant is that? Well, God told Abraham that he's going to be their God forever. Nothing's going to separate him from that. He also said that you're going to multiply greatly, that you won't be able to keep count of how many there are. If we keep reading, verse 17, it says, which he confirmed to Jacob as a statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as your portion. Verse 19, when you were few in number, of little account, and sojourners in it, wandering from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he allowed no one to oppress them. He rebuked kings on their account, saying, touch not my anointed ones. Do my prophets no harm. Remember, in the midst of them traveling the wilderness, they were never overtaken by anyone. God protected them for 40 years. He's saying, don't forget that. Also, in verse 22, says he's calling them his anointed ones, his chosen people. God's not going to forsake you. He's calling you his own. But there are so many more ways that the Lord has provided for them besides that. He wants them to remember these things so that they don't forget to seek him through it. So as Israel got a reminder of, hey, recall what the Lord has done in the past, it's the same thing for us. Are we writing down the things that God has provided for us in 2022? Are we actually like remembering the things that God has given us? Or are we just living day to day and just forgetting all these things? And I want to challenge you to really write a list. What has the Lord provided? What has the Lord done for you in 2022? Because when you remember what he's done in 2022, you know in 2023 when you run in situations where it'll, you know, your faith is tested, there might be a trial where it's like, well, we don't have enough money to do this. You remember that he provided. You remember that he made a way, even though logistically we only make this much money, but then the Lord provided in the past. He'll do it again. Why? Because he's faithful. So some of you might, as you're making this list, some of you might have hit like a milestone anniversary this year. Some of you might have had your first grandchild, or like Flay, having your first child, like that's a big deal. Hope you're sleeping. There's a lot of things you could be thankful for. Why? Because, again, everything is from the Lord. But that's not for everyone. 2022 might have been the hardest year for someone, some of us here. And that's okay. Maybe you dealt with some sickness, or you know family that dealt with sickness. Maybe you lost someone near to you. Maybe there's a prodigal son or daughter that you're praying for, that just nothing's changed and you're just tired. I've poured out so much. Well, there's good news, because the Word of God gives us hope. Even though we might grow weary, God's going to be faithful and provide. He'll do it when his timing is right. And the beauty in that is the Lord's still working. Charles Spurgeon, of course, he always comes up with saying these incredible things. He says, God is giving you grace, so give him thanks. If you have nothing else, be happy that God has given you grace. I'm like, that is such a good reminder for me, because I get so lost, so consumed in these things. Don't forget the salvation that we have in Christ. Write that down. Don't get numb to the gospel message. Why? Because the grace and the mercies of the Lord are new every single morning. We can't take that for granted. So write these things down. Why? Because when you seek God, he works. When we draw near to the Lord, he draws near to us. That's what it says. So draw near to God. How are you going to do that in 2023? You need to spend time. You need to spend time with him. Again, now's the time of the year where what New Year's resolution, what are we going to do? Well, read your Bible every single day this year. Plan to read through the entire Bible this year. Maybe you've never done that. Go for it. Why don't you pray out loud or on your knees? Like, get in a posture that takes your eyes off of yourself and on God. Because when you recall the work of the Lord, your faith gets stirred up. You can't help it. You just want to keep going and growing because in your weakness, God comes through for you always. And his name gets glorified. So sing a song, remembering all that he's done. That's point number one. Point number two, sing your song fervently. Sing your song fervently. So as David finishes in verse 22, talking about remembering the covenant of God with his people, in verse 23, he's talking about worshiping within yourself, remembering, seeking, going to the Lord within you, to going and telling people about what God has done. Going and telling people about the Lord. If we read verse 23 and 24, it says, sing to the Lord all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among the people. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. What are we doing? Who's this for? Well, we're singing. Who's singing? Well, all of us. What are we singing? We're telling of his salvation from day to day. We're declaring his glory. Everything that we're recalling from the past, we're telling people now. And that's what David's doing here. He wants everyone to go back, take what you learned, now go share it. Why? Because we're not just stirring each other, not like ourselves, but I'm going to stir one another. We're going to stir each other by sharing what God has done in our life. And it says, declare among the glory. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works in all his people. Because it's not for us, it's for each other. We're going to glorify God by sharing that. And when I think of sharing the gospel, I don't think in my life I've done a really good job with that. But going back to the World Cup in 2014, I did a great job inviting as many people as I could to Grant Park to watch USA versus Ghana. In 2014, Grant Park would, every time USA played, they would have massive projectors with thousands of people coming to watch these games. And the soccer games were incredible. And the first game of the 2014 World Cup for USA, they played Ghana. They actually scored in the first minute. The place lit up. It was loud. I invited like 20, 30 people there, and they all came, and we all started shouting. It was incredible. However, with 8 minutes left in the game, U.S., let Ghana score. Everyone starts murmuring and just like, man, can't believe it. They played the whole game and they gave it up at the end. So then people start leaving. There's still like 4 or 5 minutes left in the game. And with 2 minutes left in regulation, U.S. actually scores a game-winning goal. And as people have their backs like turned, they're walking out roaring. Like people are screaming. There's air horns going out. It was like the loudest thing I've ever encountered in my life. And again, as a soccer fan, I literally, like, my friends and I still talk about this. They're like, this was the greatest experience. It's one thing to go to a soccer game, but when you have 10,000 people all cheering, we're all on top of each other. It was so loud. It was incredible. We still talk about that today. Watch the World Cup, and hey, remember that time we were there? It was wild. It was amazing. We tell everyone that story. Everyone I know knows that story. Again, here comes the Holy Spirit. He's like, great, you shared that story with how many people, but did you share my name with all those people? I was like, man, why he's hitting me deep today. I'm like, what's going on? But I'm not just talking about sharing the gospel with non-believers. This is sharing our stories of what the Lord's doing with one another. The people that you sit next to in church, do they know what the Lord's doing in your life? In our small groups, in our growth groups, community groups, like, do they know how the Lord's working in your life? Because you could be encouraging someone else and their family by what you're going through. Because maybe you've gone through something so that you could share with someone else and help them while they're going through it. But you're not sharing it because you're just keeping it to yourself. You see, David wants us to share these stories to remind each other how amazing God is, how mighty he is. So don't waste your time on things that don't matter. I'm here talking about soccer more than I'm talking about Jesus. What am I doing? I need to get to work. We serve an almighty God, and we should fervently share the Lord in our lives. But how can we do that if we're so consumed by worthless idols, as it's saying in verse 25? We need to put away these things. So in 2023, what are you going to put away? It's January 1st. You get to start right now. What are you going to put away so that you have time for the Lord? Some of you might be social media. Some of you might be going to the gym early at 5 a.m. You'll go to the gym at 5 a.m., but you won't read your Bible at 5 a.m. It's like, where are your priorities at? What's keeping you back from declaring all that the Lord has done? So we're putting away things, but at the same time, why aren't we fervently sharing the gospel? Is it fear? Is it shame? What is it? We have no excuse. So go, declare. We need to tell our neighbors, we need to tell our friends, our families, who God is, who he is to us. Because the more people that hear the word of God, the more glory God is given. Because we need to be able to share our story with everyone. And I challenge all our students to have a 1-minute version of their testimony, a 3-minute version of their testimony, a 5-minute version of your testimony, a 10-minute version of your testimony. If you're shopping and you encounter a cashier, there's your 30 seconds a minute. Hey, how are you doing? But if you're on the train, you have 10 minutes, 5-10 minutes, share that with someone. But here's the thing, we need to go to work and actually plan that out so that when we have these encounters, we actually know what we're doing. Because there's strength and joy when we share. Don't we want to give that to other people? Of course we do. So I want to challenge you. The stories that the Lord has done in the past, write those down, and then pray for God to bring someone in your life that you could share with. Who's that one person? Who's the family that you're going to share that with? Write it down. Let that be the goal this year, that I'm going to share my faith with this family, with this neighbor. And if you don't have someone, that's great. Pray to the Father. It says, until now you have asked nothing in my name, ask and you will receive. Be careful what you pray for. The Lord's going to answer your prayers. So bring it to the Lord, and he's going to bring someone to mind. But then step in faith and share the gospel. Again, I love our church and the vision of going out to make disciples. But how can we do that if we're not fervently pursuing the Lord? If we're not fervently doing so? So let's not be hearers of the word, but let's be doers. Let's actually go out. All right, almost done. Sorry, we're almost there. All right, so sing your song internally, sing your song fervently, and lastly, sing your song vertically. I hope you guys see the pattern that David's getting at here. He's going from myself to each other to God, right? Because that's what it's all about. He's stirring up the people to give praise. David's stirring up his people. Why? Because God is holy. They're bringing an offering. If we read verse 28 and 29, it says, ascribe to the Lord, O families of the people. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name. Bring an offering. Come before him. That's what they're doing. They're gathering burnt offerings, peaceful offerings. They're singing to him. Worship the Lord in splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It will never move. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea roar and all that fill it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Again, the focus went from us as people to God alone. And I love how our church does that so well, from Harvest Kids to student ministry to our weekend services, the way that we plan sets. I have the privilege of being in those worship meetings when we're building up sets and planning songs. We pick songs that are based off of Scripture. We build songs that bring us to a destination of where we're all walking in with bondage, with baggage, when we first walk into church. But by the time, right before the message, that last song, our eyes are on the Lord, right? Holy, holy is the Lord. We just sang that. We sing these songs that exalt God above every other name. We're declaring who He is. And when you have a philosophy like that, we're shifting the way that we worship, because it's not about us. It's all about God. And we're constantly reminding ourselves to worship in spirit and truth, just like John 4:24 says. Revelation 4 and 5, great glimpse of heaven, and this is why we worship the way that we do. The elders, angels, creatures in heaven all gathered in Revelation 4 and 5 around the throne room of God, and they're singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." So why wouldn't we do that here? They're singing, "Worthy are you, O Lord, our God, to receive glory and power." This is why we sing. I love the way Andy Rozier, our former worship pastor, would say, "What we do on Sundays here is a rehearsal for what we're doing the rest of eternity." How beautiful is that? The imagery of, well, we hear each other sing every single Sunday morning. Think about doing that every single day for the rest of eternity. Both all the followers of Christ. It's amazing. But here's the beauty of it. If we don't do it, guess what? God's still going to get the glory. "Let the sea roar and all that fill it. Let the field exult and everything in it." The trees will even be singing for joy. Because if we don't do it, God's still going to get that praise. Why? Because He's worthy of it all. He deserves it. That's why we sing. So as we come to a close, I just want to challenge you this year. How are you going to grow in 2023 by worshiping the Lord? How are you going to become a zealous follower of Christ this year, unlike you never have before? Well, David taught us to give thanks and to remember all that the Lord has done. Write these things down. It's great to recall all these wonderful works that the Lord has done, but don't keep it to yourself. Go share it. Go share it with other people. Why? Because that's what we were created to do. Because we're going to bring glory to God through that. We need to go tell other people about the faithfulness of God. We need to go tell people about Psalm 23. "When your heart is restless, how the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Share that with people to bring comfort to their life, to bring hope, to bring peace. Tell of His marvelous works and declare His glory among the nation. If we truly are followers of Christ, we'll go to our neighborhoods and do that. We'll go to the stores, supermarkets, wherever we are, and share the gospel of Jesus. Or you can grow by giving praise to God for who He is. You can come to church every single Sunday morning and worship with us here. Or you could take time during the week and actually worship, reflect on who God is. We could pause our busy schedules, our task, our daily routine to take a step back and just listen to the Lord. So many times in our walk with the Lord, I have to do this. I have to read my Bible. I have to pray. I have to do these things. And God's like, "Well, when can I talk? I can't speak if you're constantly doing stuff." So maybe we have to take a step back. Because when we do, the Lord's going to speak and the Lord's going to work. How are we going to grow this year as followers of Christ? We're going to grow by being better worshipers, acknowledging who God is, because He's worthy, because He's holy. Because at the end of the day, everything that we have is from him. And then everything that we have is for him. So what are we going to do? We're just going to give it right back. Romans 11:36, I pray this over you, your families. This is something that we should remember on our hearts for the rest of our lives. Romans 11:36 says, for from him and through him and to him are all things, everything that we have. To him be the glory. May that be on our hearts this year as we try to live for the Lord, as we go out, encounter new families, new relationships to share the gospel with. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this word that you've given us today. And I'm just thankful for your word that is true, that is alive, that is working in our lives. And I pray that we take Romans 11:36 and really place it on our hearts. We memorize it. That we live it out, Lord. Remembering that all that you've done by sending your one and only Son to die on the cross for our sins, Lord, how humbly you brought Jesus to earth and how humbly Jesus went back to sit at the right hand of God. He fulfilled the commandments of the Father, and Lord, I'm helping and I'm praying that you help us today. Help us, Lord, live for you, remember all that you've done, and help us to share your gospel. This world needs it now more than ever, and Lord, we just want to give it all back. Everything that we have is yours, Lord, because you are worthy of it all. Pray all this in the precious and beautiful name of Jesus. Amen.